Thank you very much, Karen, and she'll be back with our first panel. But before we kick off the first panel, we have a special treat for you. We're lucky enough to have the filmmaker in one of the subjects of an exciting new film. It premiered at the Sundance Film Festival, won an award, and it's called Gideon's Army. And Don Porter and John Rapping are here with us today. The film follows four idealistic public defenders in the South as they fight tooth and nail for their clients amid impossible caseloads and impossible odds. Gideon's Army will premiere later this year on HBO, but you're going to get a sneak peek of it right now.
Jaquise, stand up. Jaquise Welter is not guilty of false imprisonment, attempted false imprisonment, terroristic threats, or battery. Sit down. The judge is going to tell you that the state fails to prove that case. It is your duty. You must acquit. That's the beauty of this system. It's set up to give people the presumption of innocence, to give them an opportunity to not just be heard, but hold the state accountable. You want to take my liberty, you got to do it right. And if you don't, acquit. The Fifth Amendment to the United States Constitution guarantees it. As I've made my objections throughout this trial, it's to make sure that this kid gets a fair trial. It's not a big case, is what they say. They are saying that they have the gall to say that this is not a big case. There are huge consequences. This boy will become a convicted felon. That's the reality of it. That's what this case represents. Thank you.
That you've reached a verdict in the case.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, Madam Clerk, if you'll please publish the verdict. In the Superior Court of Hall County, State of Georgia versus Jaquise Michonne Welchel, we, the jury, find the defendant not guilty. This second day of November 2011, count one, jury four.
My goal is to fill this wall up. And then once I fill this wall up, I don't know what I'm gonna do. Hopefully, like, my whole office will just be covered in acquittals. I decided since the wind's going the wall, the losses have to go somewhere. And I'm gonna tattoo, I don't have any tattoos, and I'm gonna get the last name of every case I've lost. That's what I'm gonna back up. Right now, it's only five. Hopefully I won't fill my back up. That's the goal. But since the wind's going the wall, I decided the losses have to go somewhere and they're going on my back. They're going to give me a failure.
When you work as a public defender, you say to somebody, oh, I'm a public defender, and then they're like, well, what does that mean? I defend people who are charged with committing crimes. And then they'll say, how can you defend those people? I tell them the truth. I mean, the truth is, it's about the sanctity of human liberty and the cost of it. If you want to take it.
Thank you.
it's important, I think, for the clients to see us and kind of keep their morale up and know that we have, you know, their best interests at heart. I know in particular with me, how I interrelate with my clients, I see them as cousins or brothers, some uncles, just because the face of the Black community is, so many of them are locked up. And of course, I'm having to work against their initial impression of public defenders because their first public defender somewhat screwed them.
Hi, Ms. Lewis. Good. Maybe you could sit over here. How are you? Good, good, good. Good to see you. 2 days in a row. It's freezing outside. It really is. So, you know why I'm here. I'm here to kind of get a better understanding of what took place when you were arrested. But let's kind of go through some of your biographical information. What do you do?
I'm a certified mechanic.
You're kidding me?
No kidding.
Okay, certified mechanic. Wow. How long have you been a mechanic?
About 15 years.
Okay. So once you're released and you go back to your norm, you'll go back to working on cars and such?
I would try, because since I've been in here, I've lost my house. They've broken in and stole all my tools. Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna have to like start from scratch. I'm gonna have to leave here and go into a shelter and start from scratch.
Okay.
But after my landlord found out I was incarcerated, he filed eviction notices against me.
So where's all of your stuff?
My mom said she went to go get it the other day, but he had to lock on the door because I had court. He put an eviction notice on my door and I had court. And I told 3 guards here that I'm supposed to be in court. Mm-hmm. Okay, nobody took me to court. Mm-hmm. So in court, they ruled in landlord's favor.
Wow.
So that's
a default judgment. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that caused me to be really evicted from my house. But she said she called the courts to let them know that I was incarcerated. Mm-hmm. But she said that they haven't really did the eviction yet. So he just like holding my stuff.
Okay, wow. Oh, thank you for letting me know that. So you were convicted of cocaine possession back in 2004.
Yeah, I admitted to it. Yes, I did. I really planned to get out of jail because I had never been in jail before. It was just my public defender. And me and her had problems. Cause she told me when I took that plea, she told me that I wouldn't be considered a convicted felon. I've been screwed around the first time by a public defender. And when they told me I had another one, I figured my life is completely over.
Your sentence was 2 years suspended, 2 years on probation. And you're right, since you were a first-time offender, you should have been eligible for non-adjudication. I'm not sure what happened. And I apologize that took place. But it's not the end of the world. It's not the end of the world. We can definitely fix
it. It's the end of my world, because that messed up a lot of stuff for me.
But we can rebound from it. I'm sure we can. I'm going to, you know, ask about the different eyewitnesses. Where were they standing? Were any of them under the influence? I mean, because it could have been anything that clouded maybe their vision, their vantage point, their perception of what took place. All right. So I will see you on Monday. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome. I've been doing well,
wow.
Shan. Oh my gosh. So what are you up to?
Well, I'm working now. Getting my life back together.
Okay, yeah. Good.
It was great. I'm glad I met her, really. True, honest to God, I'm glad I met her. If I didn't have June on my case, I think, honestly, I'd still be locked up. I think I actually would have served those years they was trying to give me. And I'm glad I had June to fight for me, you know, and actually see that there's an honest person in the system. You know, and I kind of got mixed up in it, and how, I don't know, but I'm glad I met her. I'm glad, you know, they actually have people out there that care about people that's behind bars. I'm more aware of those small things you take for granted before you get locked up. I'm happy, free, and loving life.
I'd like to ask our first panel to come up and take their seats. I'm going to start on my right and your left here, and again introduce Karen Houppert, the author of Chasing Gideon, the Elusive Quest for Poor People's Justice. And I just wanted to announce that she will be holding a book signing. The book came out yesterday, and so we'll have a book signing in the back of the auditorium during the lunch hour. You have a chance to purchase a copy and ask her to sign it. Next, Don Porter. Welcome, Don. Don is the director and producer of Gideon's Army, the clip that we just saw. Don is the founder of Trilogy Films and the director of Gideon's Army. As I mentioned, it premiered at the 2013 Sundance Film Festival and won the coveted Best Editing Award in the U.S. Documentary Competition. She's an alum of the Tribeca All Access Program, and she won the 2011 Juried Creative Promise Award for Gideon's Army. Real Screen also named Dawn as one of their 2012 Dot Hotshot 15 Emerging Directors to Watch, so we're going to watch her. She's also a graduate of Swarthmore College and Georgetown University Law Center. She was a practicing attorney at Baker and Hostetler and ABC Network Television Networks before beginning her television career. Next, we have John Rapping. He's the founder of Gideon's Promise. I met John, God, it must have been about 10 years ago when he was starting off and had this crazy idea of operating a training center for public defenders, and he did it. So he's now the president and founder of Gideon's Promise. It was formerly called the Southern Public Defender Training Center. He's also one of the featured individuals in Gideon's Army. He's the director and honors criminal justice program at Atlanta's John Marshall Law School, where he also teaches criminal law and criminal procedure, and he was integral during the post-Katrina New Orleans breakdown in the criminal justice system to help rebuild that. He's trained public defenders from all over the country. Some of the individuals who were in the film were trained by John's program. He received a Soros Justice Advocacy Fellowship, and he was named a Wasserstein Public Interest Fellow by Harvard Law School. Next, we have Maurice Caldwell. On June 30th, 1991, Maurice was convicted of second-degree murder for the fatal shooting of a man in the Alameda Public Housing Project here in San Francisco. There was no physical evidence linking Maurice to the crime, yet he was still convicted based on the false testimony of a single neighbor. Mr. Caldwell was sentenced to life behind bars. In prison, Mr. Caldwell contacted the Northern California Innocence Project for help, and they located two witnesses who actually saw the murder and said that Mr. Caldwell was not involved in any way. They located the real killer, who confessed that he was the one that committed the murder. That man is now serving a life sentence in a Nevada prison for a subsequent murder. On March 28, 2011, after more than 20 years in prison, Maurice Caldwell was free. So thank you for being here. Linda Starr is the legal director and co-founder of the Northern California Innocence Project at Santa Clara Law. She received her JD from the University of California Law Center and clerk for California Court of Appeal upon her graduation. She was an assistant district attorney in Brooklyn, where she wrote and argued post-conviction matters before the state courts and federal courts, and was a supervisor in the sex crimes unit. She also worked as a staff attorney at the 6th District Appellate Program in California, and now represents indigent criminal defendants on appeal. So from being a prosecutor to now a defender, and welcome. Next we have James Brosnahan, who is a senior partner at Morrison Foerster. He's been named among the top 30 trial lawyers in the United States. He's a lion of the trial bar. I've known him for many, many years. He's probably the most respected and recognized trial lawyer, not only here in San Francisco, but in the United States. He's practiced for over 50 years, not to make you feel old, Jim, and has done both civil and criminal trial work. He's tried more than 140 cases to verdict, including many, many high-profile cases, and was recognized as a 2012 Lifetime Achiever by the American Lawyer. So welcome to our panelists. And I'm going to start with Don, since we just watched the clip from your film. Now, what made you want to make this movie? Where did that idea come from?
So I was a civil litigator, but I was working in television at the time. I was working at A&E Television Networks. And I wasn't really enjoying all the things I was seeing on television. And I really was interested in making my own film. And then Kirsten Levingston, who you saw in the first clip, who is now at the Ford Foundation, I went to her with some documentary ideas, and she said, oh, you know, those, we don't like any of those ideas you have, but you ought to meet John Rapping. So I met John Rapping, and he invited me to go to Alabama to attend his training center, and I just couldn't believe what I saw. I think a lot of the, it, being a lawyer, I was a litigator, I didn't know anybody who was just desperate to stay in the profession and desperate to do a good job, and all of the lawyers in Rapp's program were these bright, energetic people talking about justice, and they were talking about the Constitution, and I thought that was a good story. So that's what happened.
So tell us, what was the story that you were trying to capture? I mean, how do you tell the story? How do you tell a story to a public that doesn't understand what public defenders do?
You know, I really wasn't thinking about the public. I was thinking about me as a person. And I was thinking, I'm not a bad person. I just didn't know. I just didn't know. And I think much as I agree so much with Karen that people are moved by individual stories. So I filmed for over 3.5 years. I mean, I followed each of the, I went to each of Rapp's training sessions. Gideon's Promise gets together. They have an initial 2-week boot camp, and then they get together every 6 months. So I went to all of those, and then in between those trips, I went to visit each of the individual lawyers. And I thought, if I could show people what their, because I kept wanting to answer the question, why would anybody do this job? I wanted to answer in an affirmative way. When people say, how can you represent those people? I kind of wanted to turn that around and say, you know, just kind of, how can you represent that people from the perspective of the people doing the work, and what was motivating them? And so I thought the best way to do that was just to tell it through their eyes and show kind of why they get so emotionally invested. The thing I would say is, when you make a film, it can be very lonely. You're by yourself with an editor, and you're doing what you think you should do. And so seeing with an audience, what has been the most gratifying is people are rooting for the clients. And at every screening, somebody will stand up and say, and it's young people, and they'll say, like, you know, at Sundance, this kid stands up and he goes, I'm a public defender. And there's 450 people in the audience, and they all were like, yay, they went bananas. And he said, that does not usually happen. So I think what I really love about the reaction to the film is people just getting this idea of why someone would want to do this job, and young people saying they want to show this to their parents and say, this is what I'm doing. This is why it's important to me. So that's...
Being a media person, Don, why do you think so little is known about public defenders, or, you know, the history? I don't know if you know the history here in California, but we've had public defender offices. The first one was established in 1914, and it was because a woman named Clara Foltz, who was the first woman attorney, she had to sue to become a lawyer in California, but she became a criminal defense attorney, and in the 1890s came up with the concept of a public defender's office, and spent over 20 years advocating for it, and finally it passed in 1921. But why do you think so little is known about public defenders, and how do public defenders contribute to their anonymity?
That's a great question. I'm not surprised it was a woman. But I think that much like me, the population that is served by public defender lawyers is so invisible without a lot of political power. But you add to that public defenders, I'm going to grossly generalize, so here I go, as a group, I think in the zealous representation of their clients, public defenders have seen so many injustices, they tend to be not as open to the public or to the media. And it's very hard to trust that somebody will represent your story well. And so I really encourage you to do what Karen does, which is let people see what you do. Trust them to tell the story because they will see it. They see it in this film, which every time I see it, I think it doesn't go far enough. I didn't show enough. I didn't do it. And people are moved by the story of people fighting for people. Everybody reacts and responds to that. But I think that we need some more access to your stories. I think they are the greatest hero stories. The only thing I disagree with Karen is I think my lawyers are superheroes, and Brandy, who's another lawyer featured in this, is quite a fashion plate. But there's a new energy and pride. I think taking pride in the work and expressing that pride is what I think is happening this year. So it's very, very exciting to see everybody talking about indigent defense lawyers as civil rights litigator heroes, which I think they are.
And I'm sure you're doing the film festival circuit this year, and it's going to be on HBO. But what's next for the film, and what do you see being able to do with this film, and how do people learn more about it?
So the film will be on HBO probably in July during the summer series, which is great positioning because they do a lot of marketing. We were selected as the opening night film at the Full Frame Documentary Festival, which is a 1,000-seat audience. It is their premier showcase event. I'm so proud of that. It was selected by students at Wisconsin Film Festival as their opening night film, and I love that because that was undergraduates, and they went to Sundance and they voted, and they said, this is the film we would like to bring home. So we are doing as many film festivals as we can. We just won the Audience Award and the Jury Award in Miami, and I'm partnering with the ACLU, obviously with Gideon's Promise, and doing as many speaking and community talkback events to say, you know, the film, I hope it will become a gathering point for people to use and say, this is what's happening in our jurisdiction. This show shows the experiences of just a few lawyers, but there are many people struggling to do a great job across this country, let's all keep making noise about it and talking
and
about it.
What's your website?
It's gideonsarmythefilm.com.
Okay.
So thank you so much.
Thank you. Please. A tremendous amount of work to make a film. We will be taking audience questions, so just fill out your cards, and then people will be walking around to pick those up. Now let's move to John Rapping, who's one of the individuals featured in the film. And John, I remember when you first talked about starting a training center for public defenders, no one took you seriously. So what happened? Now you created it, and you have been successfully training defenders. What motivated you to do that, and how did it all come to be?
First of all, I've been waiting 10 years to say I told you so. You know, there's no doubt in my mind that there is no civil rights struggle going on in this country that's more important than the struggle to make sure that poor people have lawyers. But it's something I really didn't understand when I started as a public defender. I started as a public defender in a really well-resourced office with manageable caseloads, and I was able to give every client what Gideon envisioned. And I did that for 10 years. And then I moved to Georgia, and I became the first training director for the new statewide public defender system in Georgia. And after 2 years there, I moved to New Orleans in the wake of Hurricane Katrina to help rebuild that office. And I really started to see that what I experienced in D.C. was the exception and not the rule. For example, I remember walking into a courtroom in New Orleans, very first time ever walked into a courtroom in New Orleans, and it was just, there were people everywhere, people in suits. You didn't know who the defenders were, you didn't know who the prosecutors were, you knew who the clients were because they were shackled together in orange jumpsuits on the side. And a judge took the bench and started calling names, and literally within seconds, he'd be on to the next name, and some voice would pop up. You didn't know who the voice belonged to, right? That would be the voice speaking for the person. A lawyer never stood next to the client, and then all of a sudden, a judge called a name, and there was no voice. And a judge turned to the orange jumpsuits and says, is Mr. So-and-so here? And the man says, I'm Mr. So-and-so. And the judge said, where's your lawyer? And he said, I haven't seen a lawyer since I got locked up. The judge said, well, when'd you get locked up? He said, 70 days ago. And then the judge said, fine, sir, sit down. And he went on processing people. And what shocked me more than the fact that a man had been locked up for 70 days without a lawyer was that no one in that courtroom was fazed. Not the judge, not the prosecutor, but most shocking to me, not the defenders, right? They had become used to a system, a level of expectation for poor people and the kind of justice they deserve. They'd become so used to it that they accepted it. And so that gave me this idea that we need to start a movement. And it needs to be a movement of public defenders who get it. And so we started building Gideon's Promise by recruiting young, energetic public defenders from all across the South to join this three-year program to get training and support. And we started with 16 lawyers from two offices, Atlanta and New Orleans. Jay Ramon, is Jay still here? Jay was in the original, in our original class, but I guess he left because he wanted to hear Karen, but not me. but today we have over 200.
Or I pissed him off.
Right. Today we have over 200 lawyers from over 30 offices across 13 states. We have a program for leaders, a program for trainers, a program for our graduates. All the lawyers that you see in Dawn's film have come through the program. So that's why I did it, because I really believed that public defenders can walk into courtrooms across broken systems and remind people of these ideals that Gideon was all about, that quite frankly, everyone in these systems has forgotten. So.
So John, tell us about what are some of the concrete steps that we can take to improve the quality of justice in terms of training lawyers. And you know, it's great that you're working with individual lawyers, but how do you create a movement? How do you reach the 15,000 public defenders? We have to also remember there are a lot of private attorneys and contract attorneys mm-hmm. who are providing indigent defense where there are no public defender offices.
Right. Well, you know, I want to share one more very short story with you that I think helps answer that question. A couple weeks ago, a friend of mine forwarded me a link, and it was one of a public defender leader who headed up a state system, and he was testifying before a budget committee. And the committee asked him, do you have enough resources to do your job? And his response was, well, I'm in a district with five counties. And I have, so there are five courthouses, and I have five lawyers, and I have one investigator. And last year we closed 4,000 cases. Okay, that's 800 cases per lawyer. And then he said, so I'm blessed. I have enough resources. You can feel like there is one district you have given enough to. And it reinforces this idea that when you've been in a broken system for so long, you can come to accept an embarrassing low standard. And so how do we train lawyers to sort of change that? I really think that, you know, and I sort of now, although I came up with the name the Southern Public Defender Training Center, we changed it because it was such a bad name. It's not just training that we do. Because I think when people think of training, they think of learning cross-examination skills. They think of learning the law. What we're also really doing is teaching lawyers to adopt values that are missing in the system. We're giving them strategies to think about how, when they confront challenges in the system, to overcome those challenges consistent with the values that we're instilling in them. We have a mentorship program and a community that supports them and reinforces as they try to do that. And the goal is that while they're raising the standard of representation, maybe incrementally today, in 10 years, one of them will be sitting at that table. One of them will get that question and they won't muff it, right? They will answer it correctly. I don't have enough resources. And so the movement is about teaching people to be better lawyers today, but also building an army of people across the region and ultimately across the country who will work their ways into positions of power where they're leading public defender offices, they're hiring people behind them, they're going to legislators and advocating, and they're doing, quite frankly, Jeff, what you do so well all the time. You are out there in the public convincing people that public defenders matter.
Well, believe me, it's always a struggle for me. I see my budget analyst right here, Antonio Guerrero. He knows I give him a hard time. But, you know, you talked about reaching policymakers and, you know, politicians and elected officials. How do we reach them? I mean, you could be the best lawyer in the world, but if you don't have an investigator, you don't have the resources, you're not going to be able to do a competent job. And understand that we can train individual defenders to be better defenders, but how do we get those resources?
How do we get the resources? I mean, I think, look, I think that there is a, there's not one answer to this question. I absolutely agree with Karen and Dawn that these stories move people, and we have to use these stories and books and movies to get legislators, right, who are human beings, to recognize that there's a real injustice out there. I think we need to push for more funds and more resources, and I think all of that is really important. But I think the piece that we bring to it is that in the meantime, our lawyers represent 200-400 people a year. And the most common call I get from a young lawyer, they call me up and they say, "Rap, I understand what my clients deserve, and I can't give it to them, and I think I need to quit. Right? I can't do what you all teach us to do." And I tell them about a book I recently read by a man named Bruce Watson called Freedom Summer, about the Summer Project 1964, when young people from all over the country and from the South met in Mississippi to build freedom schools and register people to vote. And Bruce tells the story through interviews of these young people. And they talk about how they went down there thinking they could change the world. And then they started knocking on doors, and people said, "Get away from here. There was a church down the street just bombed. I want nothing to do with you." And they started feeling discouraged. And they started thinking, "Maybe I'm wasting my summer." Bruce Watson fast forwards 40 years to an interview with John Lewis. And John Lewis says, "You know, if it weren't for Freedom Summer, Barack Obama wouldn't be in the White House." And what I say to our lawyers is, every day you get discouraged, but you're saving a few people this year that would have fallen through the cracks. And next year you'll get a little better and you'll save a few more. And 40 years from now, our children are going to see a better criminal defense, public defense system because of you. So our lawyers are changing the world. Public defenders are changing the world every day, and you don't realize it because you're caught up in this morass of injustice. And so I think part of it is supporting the public defenders to incrementally change today, to advocate with stories, to try to get the resources that we need, and to ultimately build a movement where the voices are just too loud. You can't ignore the voices saying, right, remember what Gideon said, we're not close, this is a civil rights issue, and we need to shame the country into stepping up to the plate. And if anyone wants to learn more about Gideon's Promise, I've got some brochures here, which I'm happy to hand out.
And what's your website?
The website is www.gideonspromise.org.
Okay. Thank you. Now, Maurice, can you tell us about your personal story and how you were wrongfully convicted?
My personal story came about in the year 1991. I was convicted of a second-degree murder, a shooting into an occupied car, and attempted murder. And it all erupted from the area I was from. I was from Alamany Projects in San Francisco off the, I forgot the highway, but I was a very, you know, interesting person, you know what I'm saying, of character from that projects. You know, I was, like you say, no angel, you know what I'm saying, whatsoever, but I also wasn't the killer. You know, and by me being from the projects of where I'm from and me having conflicts with, you know, several and different individual officers, that brought me to the interest of a murder investigation. It put me and right in the loop of a murder investigation with no evidence, no, you know, investigation working whatsoever. It was just, you know, from a personal conflict between me and one San Francisco police officer that led the whole conviction. No.
And you were sentenced to life in prison.
Yeah, I was sentenced to 27 years to life for the crime.
I mean, you had a lawyer representing you. Do you feel that your lawyer did what?
I didn't have a public defender, you know, because it was like I needed that lawyer that African guy had up there. You know, every lawyer, you know, that I interviewed, even the public defenders, some of the good lawyers they had, but I went with somebody that wasn't go just sit down to the truth, you know what I'm saying, was go, you know, get in the courtroom, just how he told his clients, sit down, you know, stand up, you know. I needed somebody with that authority, so I went with, my family paid somebody, a lawyer, to fight my case, and throughout my whole case, this lawyer didn't investigate, he didn't go to the crime scene, he didn't subpoena witnesses to come to court, or none of that, you know. But along with that, even, you know, with the homicide inspectors and the DA and them knew about the crime, you know, it was clearly, you know what I'm saying, that somebody else committed the crime, but due to my bad act character and the way I was, my uprising, you know, I was the only one, you know, was left to, you know, take the fall for it.
Once you've been convicted of a crime, it's almost impossible to get a conviction reversed. How were you able to do that?
Man, you know, like person say hope, you know what I'm saying? You know, for people that live in society, you really don't know what hope is until you come to, you know, a life-threatening situation or a real critical situation, and then you start saying, I hope this, I wish that. Okay, through every day of my life in prison, you know what I'm saying, I had hope. You know what I'm saying? And my, you know, my hope was just like fail, you know? Like every day, you know, I was hoping and praying that I'd get out. My story, you know, would be not just heard, because the story was heard. You know what I'm saying? Somebody would believe me, you know what I'm saying? And not look at where I come from and not look at, you know, my bad act character and, you know, understand that I didn't commit the crime, you know? So hope to me was like, it was overwhelming, and, you know, every time I got in contact with, you know, like somebody that I thought that could help me or even interest in my case, that was hope. You know what I'm saying? If I could write a letter to a person, you know what I'm saying, and they could listen and read my letter, that was hope to me. You know what I'm saying? That maybe, you know, they could react and even write me back, you know? So in prison, it was like without hope in prison, you know what I'm saying? And without, you know, like, I wanted to say something. I jump from around, but I want to say, you know, Jeff Adachi, you know, the public defender office was something, you know, that really helped me. You know what I'm saying? Because it was Jeff Adachi, like, that really opened the door, ignited, you know what I'm saying, my investigation into my case from his office. He opened an office in San Francisco for Innocence Project. So I was one of the persons that was able to get a lawyer from that Innocence Project. But then after having that lawyer for a certain time, the Innocent Project at his office, had to let it go because they had too many, you know, cases, you know what I'm saying, too much other attention to do. So they referred my case to the Santa Clara, you know what I'm saying, Innocent Project with Linda Starr. And from there on, that's when faith came in, you know. I didn't have no more hope. Hope was, you know, died out. You know what I'm saying? I invented faith. You know what I'm saying? Now I'm here. Now I'm here, you know what I'm saying? I'm blessed, you know what I'm saying? And I'm honored, you know what I'm saying, to see that there's so many people that's interested in, you know, the system that, you know, it's clear as day, is broke. You know what I'm saying? Can't not one person in society, you know, ever say, you know, the system is not broken. For everybody, you know what I'm saying, who could feel the same and know the same thing, you know what I'm saying, it shouldn't be hard to come together, you know what I'm saying, and try to help. You know what I'm saying? Like I say, Gideon Promise, I never knew about it. I always heard somebody say, but now just listen. I mean, looking at the movie, it was moving to me, you know what I'm saying? Because that's something I did many a times, sat in my cell or just wrote somebody, you know what I'm saying, to try to hear my cry for help, you know, and I finally got it, you know what I'm saying? So, that, like I say, faith brought me here, you know what I'm saying? Now my hope has been restored through to the Innocent Project, you know what I'm saying?
Thank you. Now, Linda, you've seen story after story similar to Maurice's. What are the common threads that you see, and what can be done to reduce wrongful convictions?
Well, there's several causes of wrongful conviction, and almost always in every case, it's a confluence of a variety of causes. It's rarely just one single cause, and it would be that case in Maurice's case as well. He did have an ineffective attorney. He hadn't gone to Mr. Rapping's college, and he was not a public defender, and he has since been disbarred. It was his one and only criminal case. He shouldn't have taken the case to begin with. And it was with the help of the public defender's office that we, initial help with their office, Jeff's office, that we were able to get Maurice's case overturned ultimately. But as Maurice has said many times about his case, I wouldn't have needed an attorney if the police and prosecutors had done their job right to begin with. And he's right, and I don't want us to lose track of that. His attorney was shamefully and woefully inadequate, but he wouldn't have been in that position to begin with if everyone else had done their job properly. And in many of our cases, what we find is that complacency that John was talking about is pervasive in our system, and it's very difficult for those working in the trenches every day to overcome that complacency and confront the system that is not giving them the evidence that they need in order to do their job and that their client is entitled to under the Constitution, that's not sharing that information that they're entitled to get, that doesn't provide them the resources to get the experts that they need in order to challenge the experts that the prosecution has. For example, in an arson case, where we now know many of the experts on arson aren't experts at all, and the fire wasn't an arson to begin with. So things like that contribute greatly to wrongful convictions. And then if you have evidence that isn't disclosed, you have experts that aren't challenged because there's no resources, and you have a system that's burdened a public defender with too many cases, it is almost impossible for them to not be complacent and be cowed by the system. So we do have to remember to be vigilant in challenging a system that doesn't give our clients what they are entitled to.
You know, Linda, I know that you're a former prosecutor, and I wanted to ask you, what is it about the culture of prosecution or prosecutors that allows wrongful convictions? I know there have been stories of prosecutors who have been responsible for exonerating individuals who they believed were wrongfully convicted, but that's the exception, not the rule. I remember just seeing the Ken Burns documentary, Central Park 5, and after, you know, five young men were imprisoned and later exonerated, they interviewed the prosecutors, and the prosecutors still maintained they were guilty, even though there was evidence, clearly scientific evidence, that pointed to their innocence or proved their innocence. What do you think would have to change in terms of the culture of the criminal justice system that would prevent this in the future?
Well, the win at all cost mentality has to go. I think that there's this notion of tunnel vision, and that's the colloquial version for what's actually very well-known human behavior, which is how difficult it is for a human being to not come up with a conclusion first and then look at the facts that go to support that conclusion. We all suffer from it in one way or another, and prosecutors suffer from it greatly. They've committed a lot of resources to a prosecution. They really and truly believe the person. I'm not talking about the evil players who don't care whether somebody's innocent or guilty, but I believe most of them think that they're going after the correct person and that they think that that's what they've done. And it is very difficult for them to back out of that and take a hard look, to step back and take a hard look at it. And you're right, it has been really difficult for us to get any traction in many prosecutors' offices to do that. And to not only do it and then say, well, let's let the judge decide, but to actually step up and say, I'm not going to make this have to be a judge that decides this. I'm going to own it and say, we made a mistake. When we have prosecutors that do that, and when we are able to convince them to do that, we have to honor that and recognize that what it did take them to be able to step forward and do it. And it's not just the prosecutors, it's also our attorney generals have to be able attorneys general have to be able to step back and say, okay, courts have approved this conviction, they've affirmed this conviction, they haven't reversed it, but I'm convinced that it's wrong. And I don't know how to do it other than to constantly point out to them, plead with them, meet with them, have those that know them and respect them, ask them to give you an audience and to try to convince them that that is the right course for them to take.
Innocence projects, most of them are privately funded, or they rely on local fundraising, and you know they're not funded as government entities. It's very difficult to do the work that you do, and I commend you for it. What kind of demand do you have for the services that you provide?
An unmeetable demand. You are right, we're privately funded and we scrounge for funds constantly to keep ourselves in existence. We are associated with Santa Clara University School of Law. We're a clinical program so that we not only get to use students to work on our cases, but we also get to teach them and try to get them to understand those things that John was talking about, how they need to question. Don't go into court and when a judge says, the statute for post-conviction DNA testing says that you're entitled to counsel, but the government hasn't appropriated any money for it. So yes, I'm appointing you counsel, but I'm suspending that appointment because there's no money to pay for the attorney. Don't walk out and say, well, the judge says we can't do it. Teach them to question those kinds of those incidences. And then, because we have no money, we reach out to the local bar, law firms like Jim's law firm or Chris's law firm to help us in representing cases and even sometimes civil rights situations where we're trying to establish the right to counsel or reinforce that it's the client is entitled to counsel in a certain situation. So we get between 800 and 1,000 requests for assistance a year. We read every one within a month. From that first request, we're usually able to triage it down to about half. Many of them that write to us are not really claiming to be innocent. They are probably claiming that their prison conditions are inadequate, and they're probably right. They might be claiming that they haven't received their medication. They're probably right. They are often complaining that they were overcharged and over-sentenced. They're probably right. We refer them as much as we can to those that might be able to help them. From then, we begin the triage process of doing some kind of investigation into every case to see if there's any possible claim of innocence that we might be able to A, investigate, and B, once we investigate it, is there any way for us to litigate it?
Okay, thank you. Next, I'd like to ask Jim, you know, poor people who are accused of a crime have a right to a public defender, but some of the most important decisions are made in civil court. Child custody, workers' rights, compensation for catastrophic injuries. Where is the Gideon for poor people who are seeking justice through the courts?
Well, it's not there, but I can tell from this crowd that you'll be sympathetic to what I'm about to say. Because when you start caring about these issues, they expand, and that's okay. The question that I will address, and I've been interested in it since 1962, I'm quite mature, and been working on it my own little way, it has to do with the right to counsel in civil cases. I'll tell you three stories and it'll be very brief. Because I agree with the idea that if I give you the statistics, if I just sit here and I tell you 6 out of 10 middle-class people who go to civil court in the United States do not have a lawyer, or I say 8 out of 10 who go to civil court do not have a lawyer, I have diminished those people. And in this culture, that's one way to take care of the problem, because it's almost gone when you hear it. But I'll tell you three stories. A U.S. citizen, born and raised in Hawthorne, California, with a limited mental capacity, at the age of 28, having been schooled in the United States, having lived in the United States, living with his mother and three other kids in that family, younger kids there, with the mother taking care of him, got arrested on a small trespass. He entered what I can only call a sort of criminal factory known as the main jail in Los Angeles, where they process, and you can almost feel bad for them, but not quite. They process thousands of people. People with Hispanic names are called out to go down and be interviewed. He did not have the capacity to explain. What I just told you was his background. He was on a bus. He went to the Immigration Service. He was on a bus. He was taken to Tijuana, and he was released. No lawyer in that process. Every religion that I'm familiar with teaches that things like that are not the right way to go. And we do have public officials who are happy to mention their own religiosity. And I always get a kick out of it, and I check their voting records, because on this issue and on your issue, they are part of the problem. Who are they? They are your friends. They are the people you like. You like their environmental things. They have other things. And these things, I've tried to talk to them, and so have others, much more powerful than I am. He was there in Mexico for 3 months. He had a mental breakdown. He thought he was dead. To check whether he was dead, he stepped out in front of a truck. It missed him. And his mother began to tour day in and day out in the places where they keep the dead bodies in Tijuana. And finally, he wandered back up, and someone, by then, the lawyers, the ACLU, had made a big thing. I represented him. We brought a suit. The government was unrepentant. Two, if you go across the street to the fifth floor over there, you will see people waiting in line, and I've stood there. The best thing to do on these issues is to go to the place and look at the people. That's the way to do it. And then be a voice coming out as best you can to say, here's what I saw. And on the fifth floor, there are people, some of them fairly well-dressed, the middle-class people that I just mentioned in my statistics, who are going into a room to get some kind of advice as to how to handle their particular matter, which includes questions of their connection to their children. And there's a woman there in the line, and she thinks that her former husband molested her oldest child, and he now wants custody. And he has a lawyer, and she doesn't. Now, I know what lawyers do. I do my pro bono. I have to tell this crowd. I do my pro bono. Okay, all right. But I do, don't tell anybody, I do money bono too. All right. And I go into CEOs' offices, and I don't go alone. There's five of us. I mean, we have theories, we have arguments. And we try to bring that to our pro bono in our firm as best we can. We try to do that. So up in Sacramento, there's a woman who had custody, shared custody with her former husband. She's a rock climber. She fell down. She hurt her head. She's disabled, Social Security. She's an independent liver, and you talk to her. I'm going to see her on Friday. She's, okay. She goes to court. Her husband has a lawyer. She doesn't have a lawyer, and her husband is accused by her 14-year-old daughter of molesting her. And when the hearing is over, and she has no idea how to appeal, she knows nothing about the hearsay rule, she knows nothing about family law, she doesn't know the law, they wander the halls in America like the undead. I've seen them. They're out there. And it's not right. In fact, it's unacceptable. When the hearing is over, she is denied all connection to her daughter. That is what we're talking about.
What do you think it's going to take to make society and government take the first step towards civil Gideon? It's been an idea that's been talked about.
Right.
The American Bar Association has had reports and commissions. You've worked on this for many years. What's it going to take?
And the Bar Association, represented by our president who's here today. I think that, we're all proud of our city, whatever our city might be, people here from Fresno and so forth, and we're all proud of our cities. I like this city because we get ideas here that nobody else gets. And, wait a minute, though. Some of them are really bad. We're all friends here, right? But So our little committee, we're powerless in this culture. Forget about it. We're powerless. We got no clout, nothing. So our slogan is, we don't think, we do, okay? Because we don't want to study things. There's people out there studying things. So we went to a supervisor, David Chu, in this city. And we said, here's the problem. And he said, well, this is terrible. He's a practicing lawyer. Then we went before the finance committee, four practicing lawyers. They all knew what the problem was. And they enacted a statute which made San Francisco the first city in the United States to be a right-to-counsel city, and they put forward $100,000 to fund a test, if you will, about how this could be expanded and how this would work. So that's the local level. Where I am is this, and this is a little bit incendiary. I referred to the legislators. In Los Angeles at the moment, as we speak, 13,000 unlawful detainer actions, where someone is trying to get someone out of an apartment or a house, have been moved because of the cuts in the budget done by our legislators. They have been moved to out of the valley to Santa Monica and to other places. 9 out of 10 who are defending, trying to keep their apartment, trying not to be homeless, trying to keep their house, 9 out of 10 have no lawyers. On the landlord side, 9 out of 10 have lawyers. So after you drive all the way to Santa Monica, and after you try to figure out what it is, what the real property law is in California, and what defenses you might have or what arguments you might have, you are faced with a trained lawyer and someone who's been in law school for 3 years, someone who's practiced for some period of time. What we need here, to answer your question at long last, is a playwright. This is macabre. This is weird, and we are not on anyone's calendar to speak of. And that, for some of us, that's what makes it fun.
Hey, thank you, Jim. We're now going to take audience question and answer note cards, so please pass them in so we can ask your question. Let me again ask Karen Houppert to talk about, you know, you spent the last year and a half studying and observing how Gideon's promise has been broken. You know, what do you think is the biggest obstacle to closing the gap between rich people's justice and poor people's justice? And, you know, what have you learned about the solution?
Well, I think the biggest obstacle to closing this gap is the political desire to do so, which is kind of, I talked about that a little bit in my talk. But I think that, and you can learn this lesson many ways. I don't know if you guys, in terms of when you're at work, I sometimes find like I have to learn the same lessons over and over, and they're a big epiphany for me each time. I'm like, oh. And the epiphany I had while I was working on this book was when I went into this whole issue as a journalist, and as a journalist, I'm a feature writer and I'm a generalist, so I'm not a lawyer. I don't know this world. And I was really drowning in it for the first 6 months when I was reporting. I didn't know what was going on in court. I didn't know the language. I didn't know the process. It was all very complicated. And then I had my little epiphany, which was that actually I should listen to that little voice in my head that is disoriented and realize what this experience is like for clients who are going through this system. It is completely disorienting, and they don't know. And you know, how do you convey that? If you can, you know, for me, if there was a way to convey that sense of complete disorientation, then you really understand the need for an attorney. I mean, it's so clear. And so I think for me, it was really a way of understanding what this process was like for clients who are going through the system, and conveying that to people and letting them understand or walk in a client's shoes for a while. And then there are lots of other complicated systemic problems that need to get addressed that all of you are probably well aware of: the finance problem, structural problems, cultural problems, all of which John Rapping has talked about. Yet all of them, I think, hinge on this larger issue of public pressure and understanding, and really pushing politicians, legislators, everyone that you have an opportunity to talk to, so that they understand what's at stake here. Because I do think that really, I really believe that Americans are interested in fairness. I admit I'm a glass half full kind of person, but I believe we really care about fairness. It's like so primary to the way that we think. You know, you think of little kids, you know, arguing. It's one of the first arguments they have. Wait, you know, she got more chocolate milk than me. That's not fair. You know, there's this primary instinct in which we really believe in fairness. So I think that the real challenge for us is how do we bring the public inside this world and make them understand that this is not fair and it has to change. So,
okay, here's our first question from the audience, and it's a question I'll put to the panel, and any of you can respond. It's a great question. Is Gideon's promise, does it extend to our nation's immigrants when they are told to plead guilty and then are deported?
I'll start with that, because I filmed in Georgia many times, and one of the trials I filmed that is not in the film, but I'll tell you about, really just, I think about it like still a lot. A man who is accused of drug trafficking, although the police report, as the police officer testified on the stand, did not mention drugs, magically the amount of drugs that were not in the police report exceeded the threshold for 25 to life sentence eligibility, first offense. The man who was on trial, his story and the story of a man who had pleaded guilty with him was that he was a roofer in Georgia. His friend said, "Do you want to go to lunch? I just have to make a stop." He said, "Yes, I want to go to lunch." He's a passenger in the car. He's unaware that there are drugs in the car. His friend was doing a drug deal. So after a day and a half trial, he's convicted on the testimony of the officer alone. He doesn't speak any English. So there is a translator who is, you know, trying her best to keep up with everything that's happening. But you can tell he has no idea what's happening. And on a day and a half after being convicted with no evidence against him, nothing to point to the fact that this man was in any way involved in trafficking crystal meth, he was sentenced to 25 years to life in prison. So in Georgia, what will happen is and so when they said guilty, I have never seen a person's face like that, and that will just stay with me forever. He did understand that word, he was taken in handcuffs and just, you know, incredulous that this could have happened to him. And so what happens is he goes to prison and now deportation proceedings begin. So I can't remember your original question, but I think the immigration situation and how we are criminalizing an effort to really deport people is one of the more disgusting and shocking things that I saw repeatedly in the course of filming.
I think just briefly that those of you who are in the immigration area, maybe as lawyers or working in that area, understand what it's like. But I tried a sanctuary case in Arizona in the 80s. I don't think there's any other, I hope there's no other place in America where the authorities treat the people that they process the way they do that. There may be some jails where they do that. But you, unless you've seen it, you cannot imagine what goes on. And they separate families. They separate families. This is a nation of family values. And so I thought in my youth that someone would come along and reform the Immigration Service. I'm still waiting. I may have to, I may not see it myself the way it's going.
Okay. Just moving to the next question. This is one for Maurice. Did you ever feel discouraged in your fight for innocence while you were incarcerated? And did you feel like it was like you against the system?
Yes. I felt that, you know, from day one, you know, because it's like, even going through trial, it was like, I felt that I had no weight, no, at my story, even if my story was true, false, it was no weight, you know what I'm saying? It was just my character from where I was from, it was like, I'm already guilty, you know? So for us, intimidation, I didn't feel intimidated, or I didn't feel like, I felt like giving up, because I always, like I said, the hope I had, you know, from going in, It deteriorated, you know what I'm saying, from me even losing faith from the system, from far as the police bringing me, arresting me, from far as my lawyer, you know what I'm saying. It was like them was the people that could help me get out, you know what I'm saying. And the same people that I felt that needed to help me get out was the ones that I was like mad at. So you know, my madness made me fight. You know what I'm saying? So I stayed fighting, but I never, you know, felt like it was gonna be over. You know, I got a niece that's 23 years old right now. Even in 2011, when my case got overturned, you know, and I called her, I said I'd be home now. You know what I'm saying? She was like, Uncle, you said that all the time. You know what I'm saying? So I never, you know, felt, you know, like giving up. You know, never. It was never, you know, no matter what, how much time I got, because I knew the facts behind it. You know, and it was like the principal facts behind it refused to let me give up no matter what. You know, even like coming home when my case got accepted, you know, my writ, you know what I'm saying? It was like, I'm going home, you know, and then like it still didn't happen, you know. I'm thinking like in 60 days, you know, the court go, I'm telling everybody, I'm going home, you know, and then this people all the time up in there, me educating myself about the law, I know. It's fast to get in there, but when the wheels are turned to come home, it's slow. You know what I'm saying? But I couldn't accept it. I couldn't accept it, you know. So it was like, people was like, no, they got to do this. They go do this to time. And I was like, no, this is clear. This was what was supposed to have been done from the beginning, you know. So it was like so much in my life, you know, that even like my family, you know, all my loved ones that I lost, you know, that made me fight even more, you know. So I never in my life, you know, gave up, you know, my faith, you know what I'm saying, but hope, my hope was gone, you know what I'm saying, and that's what I'm out here restoring, like I say now.
Okay. Thank you. With that, I'd like to thank all of our panelists. Thank you.